outside on the patio here. And because my way of thinking and expressing myself is like somewhat of a perpetual free association exercise, like I've probably talked about most of the stuff in this fourth one already, just because I get excited to talk about whatever I think makes me think about the next thing. So again, I'll move quickly, but most of this that we've covered, and once again, you'll have a full book to learn at your leisure and read inside your mind instead of having to listen about the whole thing. We'll skip the de-stressing exercise, we'll do that outside. So the future, looking at forecastable services, like what's actually going to happen, this is all theory for now, but it's just to demonstrate that like we're not that far away. As I mentioned, by Q4, those results will be through, 3B is going to be reviewed, and again, if approved, MDMA would be available in the U.S. By 2024. And this is significant, as we talked about at the very beginning, because like autistics are 35 to 42% of us have PTSD, probably. This is just like, you know, probably. The actual diagnostics are lower, and there's a great article, I'll show you in a sec, but contributing factors, just sensory experiences can be traumatic, basic everyday stuff might be traumatic, like stuff we barely remember from our childhoods. If we have an extra sensitive nervous system, like anything could have triggered that sort of like trauma-like response. Same as like transitions and change are notably difficult for this group. Sustained state of social challenge can lead to kind of like appearances of PTSD-like behavior and similar detail-focused mindset, kind of ruminating on details, like reprocessing. We said it earlier, but there's something known as like aberrant default mode network activity in some autistic studies. They've shown that. So basically like you're stuck in rumination mode. So it's quite helpful to take something that helps you like manually drop out of rumination mode. MDMA is like a massive tool for that, but even psilocybin LSD can do it in a much subtler way. To me, like MDMA, if it was as healthy to take MDMA as often as it might be, theoretically, to take LSD and psilocybin, like, the world would just be, like, holding hands and being fine. But, like, we can only take it every so often, and right now, most people can't access it, period. So, like, we don't know what it's like to really be that calm together, like, in presence like that. And if you've ever been to, like, a mass gathering of people on MDMA and, like, felt the energetic, like, vortex of, like, wow, like, this is possible to just all feel okay all at once for a second. Like, it's such a powerful thing to sync with people like that. But it can also, again, MDMA could also be helpful with, like, emotional regulation challenge, anticipating meltdowns, getting more attuned to the body, and getting ahead of certain signaling. We talk about it in, before this class, there's another book that's an introduction book. And alexithymia is something that I gravitate a lot to talking about because it's not so much talked about. It's super common in autism. 50 to 70% of people have alexithymia. And that's a difficulty in identifying or labeling inner feeling states. It's subtly different from like poor interoception processing in that you could have like a sort of cognitive barrier to being able to express yourself or process it. And like you could also have like a kind of like very basic kind of sensory based, like it's sort of like which part of the chain is causing the ineffable nature of your own somatic experience. There's lots of kind of causes, but alexithymia is really just the overarching label of like you have trouble identifying or labeling it. For me, it's like, am I hungry? Am I thirsty? Am I angry? Am I sad? I don't know. Like, I'm so living in mental space that like body space is like not my native tongue, so to speak. So tools like MDMA are profoundly useful for that, like being like, wow, body, but others as well. But it can be really also helpful because autistics might also just have a really short fuse for how much time they can spend speaking, period, in a session. They might not even make it to like a full 75-minute session without being exhausted or like frustrated or whatever. So the fear-lowering component and the stimulant property of MDMA can be profound for going deeper than anyone could have previously gone because just the way the drug works, they find the same in trauma healing. Like, wow, the person went further than they could before, and they went deeper, and they had that fear reduction that allowed them to go there, which dovetails into the last point. Autistics, by virtue of a lot of circumstances, become deeply just mistrustful of the world in general. I think a lot of us come into our community space just kind of speaking in that broad stroke of, like, the world, like, as though the whole world is not them, and the whole world is against them, and that's such a common narrative, because it's so often reinforced. That's why I think also something like our community group is so important to be like, you know, there's people that are very much like you that are also part of that so-called oppositional force that is the world, and they're not oppositional, and like illuminating that for people is really helpful. But MDMA can be like have a direct experience of that, and therapist-patient bond is the strongest predictor in a lot of psychotherapy with MDMA. And so if you can really enhance that trust with the drug agent, On the flip side, we want to be mindful of the fact that you're putting people into highly suggestible states, vulnerabilities, et cetera, et cetera. I've talked to the ethics people at the conference that know better than I. But there is this great article, again, be linked in the book we'll give you. But it's all about like if someone's diagnosed autistic, they maybe don't get to the point of getting PTSD diagnostic or treatment most critically, because they're being treated like as an autistic person rather than someone that might need trauma-informed care, and that's two very different courses of treatment. And in some cases, like things like applied behavior analysis can be re-traumatizing for some individuals. And so like it's really complicated. Like, had I gone in and like thought that like being physically abused was worthy of saying I might have CPTSD, I just didn't. It was a normal facet of my life, and so like I got the autism diagnosis, became like my path of care was like just that box. And I didn't even think about PTSD or CPTSD until people came to our group and started like being like, oh wait, that's my life. And like, yeah, I did this. I was like, wait, should I do that? Like, there's like a lot to consider. And there's this article goes into like, should we screen every autistic person for PTSD? Probably.
Yeah.
And vice versa. Like, I mean, I think I'm not trying to conflate the two and be like they are one and the same, but like there's a lot of factors that predispose autistic people to having trauma presentations. I kind of just said what I said, and now I got to the slide that says it too, but social anxiety treatment, you know, and if you're socially anxious, it can be hard for you to, like, approach a social encounter to try to resolve that. Like, hey, therapist, I want to talk to you about how I don't want to talk to people. Like, it's a difficult thing, and MDMA can really catalyze just that breakthrough moment where they can just have a fundamental retrust of humanity, period. Someone else they can trust for even just an afternoon. That could be enough motivation for them to be like, you know, it would be nice if I trusted more people. Maybe people actually do care about me. Maybe something. You know, that narrative can get so strong. The mind story can be so strong that just, like, giving someone exposure to something other than whatever echo of their past is rattling in their head can be so therapeutic. And a lot of contributing factors, which you touched on, similar to some of the other stuff with MDMA as far as, you know, having these sort of peculiarities, being othered, having sensory environments that might not be suited, things like that. And similarly, again, go listen to Gull's talk at the conference where she talks about reopening critical periods, super fascinating. But the shortish version is like, if you were socially reclusive as a child, adolescent, and you're like, well, it's kind of like if you didn't learn a third language before you were 10, you're like, well, you're probably not going to learn as well as that 10-year-old will. And the same goes for, like, social learning. So the theory goes that, like, maybe we could, like, teach old dogs new tricks and be like, this person was socially inclusive until they were 40 could potentially, like, be, like, kind of neurologically rehabilitated into social learning, that we could reopen that critical period and, like, ingrain new patterns, which is, like, profoundly impactful. For autistic people, probably, like, anyone, really, for trauma survivors, whatever, but for autistic people, especially those who are very, like, you know, avoidant attachment style growing up, to develop a secure attachment style at all, it can be just, it's every other benefit comes from connection, and if we can open that and create potential for that with MDMA, it'd be wonderful. And I've seen it firsthand in plenty of social gatherings where I've seen people just, we had a group gathering at one point, and someone just literally said that afterwards, they're like, I like being around people. And I was like, yeah. They're like, no, like, I realized that. Like, I realized that I like people, like, period. Like, that I should be around people. I'm like, you're around people all the time. They're like, no, but, like, but I'm going to be, like, with them now. Like, I'm going to be, like, with them now. And I was like, all right, whatever, yeah, I get it, but, like, yeah. But, like, that's, like, the breakthrough of, like, they're looking for the rational solution in a sea of solutions. Like, all the people around them are the solutions that they're looking past because they're not safe. People around them aren't safe. That's not a source of safety, so it's ignored into, like, a pursuit of some phantasm of what will be wellness. But wellness comes from, like, connection, comes from asking for help, all this stuff that just doesn't feel safe. So if we can put people in, like, radically safe feeling spaces, that's what, there's a great metaphor used by Dr. Sessa in the alcohol study. He said, like, the same way a traumatic event can be, like, can implant, like, a deeply, like, terrifying experience, MDMA of, like, having a deeply safe feeling experience can also, like, implant that feeling to last ongoing as well. And, like, be like, ah, like, that's been, like, kind of conditioned that this is possible. And that can hold as, like, a pattern of behavior and outcome. This is too complicated to explain in my current mind state. And supervised psilocybin we talked about as well, again, like, as far as, we talked about, like, if you're interested as a clinician, if you're interested as a recipient, I know I'm kind of sometimes speaking in judgmental terms of, like, cost this, cost that. It's rooted in the knowledge that 80% of our population are under the poverty line. And I'm, like, always looking out for how much does something cost, because if it costs anything, most people that are autistic can't afford it. But there will be still centers, and they are open to adults 21 and older. You don't need any diagnostic in order to receive services because they're not treating anything specifically. You just have to pass a screener, and they have some like novel models around like how you could theoretically go and even try microdosing. The most expensive microdose known to man would be like $500 for like a 2.5 milligrams, which translates to like roughly like 250 milligrams of like whole fruit psilocybin. But that's available, and for some people it's really helpful to have like a fully overseen and fully checked quality tested session, and that is available, and like basically September of this year the first sessions will start, and you can like look those up, and I work for some centers over there as well. And there's also this interesting thing, I don't think anyone, this was like 6 months ago when there was this funny loophole that they developed, which was like, if you take a low dose, you only have to stay at a center for like 30 or 60 minutes. And there was this thinking at that time, which I don't think anyone's actually going to bear the risk, was that like people could like take a dose supervised and then go do therapy elsewhere. Like kind of like while it's, like you can transport it in your gut. And those centers do, like the center's obligated to keep you for a minimum of that time. As we've seen it actually play out though, most centers, even if you're microdosing for the sake of liability, they're still monitoring you for like 5 or 6 hours. I mean, they basically like babysit you because they're like, well, you took a quarter of a gram of mushrooms, like you're fine. But like this was like a hypothetical model of like if you wanted to do like sound healing ceremonies adjacent, maybe you could do it without breaking any laws, but no one's really taking on that risk, and it's kind of wonky, and the underground or community care layer kind of does that anyway. It's just a note that like anywhere from 0.5 grams of whole fruit all the way up to 5 grams of whole fruit is like the kind of boundaries in Oregon for session work. So this is probably the most interesting thing to me, is like theoretical future models. Even drugs aside, interoception training is wonderful. Like it's not... hasn't been gotten a whole lot of like attention, mainly because it's not fully validated. There's a couple of studies about neuroception training. There's also synonyms for like any kind of somatic work. But Kelly Mahler, she's an OT and she developed it. It's a really great, I think it's just useful for anyone. It's basically like exercises just to like notice your body. Be like, dude, 20 jumping jacks, like, can you find your heart? And it's like, yes, it's targeted towards children, but also like even using it at any layer. It's just like really practical exercises, just like feel into your body. But interoception training is like one thing which I think could be further enhanced by like having like a low dose of something like psilocybin and being like, wow, I really feel it in my body, and like when I do that, oh, that means like I'm putting too much weight there, or you know, Ian McCall is like a UFC fighter, he talks about this all the time, how much like his like nuanced agility is so enhanced in those states, and for people that are going from like dissociated to like felt, it's like just as significant as like an enhancement might be. But there's also a validation that psilocybin in general population is increasing the ability to emotionally regulate, perceive bodily sensations, and also to make integration of those sensations as well. It's been validated in a bunch of different studies with psilocybin in general population. Psychedelic social skills group, again, this is kind of like reframing like what we're doing here a bit. Typically, social skills groups involve like role playing, different situations, things like that, like practicing making eye contact, which, depending on which side of the fence you stand, may not be an important part of communication. It might just be one of those, like, if we allow that to be normal, then it's normal kind of things. In autistic majority spaces, which are like newly possible, like I've been in these like all autistic people retreats, there's also this sort of like natural rehabilitation that comes about just from like normalizing stuff, or people just being like, hey, I'm gonna go like freak out in that corner for 5 minutes. Everyone's like, you can do that. Like, and like we can like communicate our needs like that, and like that's just as freeing as being like, oh, I take this drug so I don't freak out. It's like, no, like maybe you need to freak out, go freak out over there for 5 minutes, come back, like it's fine. And so it's a matter of like being more malleable with spaces, and most of this stuff is predicated on, can you fit into public school, yes or no? The parents are having to cram their kids into public school because it's expensive to not have public school babysit your kid. So, like, we're all beholden kind of to, like, that kind of quiet framework that, like, we're all raised through public school mostly, at least in the States. And a lot of this is predicated on, like, how, like, obedient, how, like, static can you be in a classroom, how long can you focus, things like this. OT, I think, also has a lot of opportunity. We see it already in cannabis work. We have a lot of people that are OT instructees in our group that are using cannabis in conjunction to help with restlessness and just generally, like, have the kids just kind of be more vibey in general. Not a medical term, but, like, having, like, cannabis oil assisting with these exercises where kids are prone to frustration or outbursts can be really exceptional. And if you can have that enhanced, like, interoceptive processing, all the better. Again, these are just some examples of OT work, but I'll skip over. But just some validation, you can look at the studies when I pass this out as well, but just that psilocybin has already been kind of validated as enhancing creativity, problem solving, improved mood, enhanced self-awareness, introspection, and all this stuff, which could map over autistic populations. CBT is really just conventional psychotherapy. I'm going to skip that for now. Something that's not very much talked about, but is interesting when it comes up in our group, because it has a lot, is whole families doing sessions together. And parents coming to our group being like, my son needs help. And like they come to three or four of the sessions, they're like, hey, I'm stressed. hey, I also need to work on this. Hey, wait, I think I'm autistic after listening to all these people talk about autism. Like, there's a lot of overlap in a lot of these trait presentations. And I've heard some really beautiful stories there. I was on the Psychedelic Mom podcast, and we had a conversation about her and her daughter taking psilocybin together and, like, healing this sort of, like, I'm sorry for all the ways you failed me both ways. Like, they both were saying that and being like, wait, we both were trying so hard. And, like, that moment is beautiful. It can be deeply healing, you know. I wish that was our Thanksgiving tradition instead. but, like, it could be helpful. It's to not leave out the fact that, like, parents are also, like, some people in autism advocacy spaces would be triggered to be like, the parents aren't the victims, the parents impose the... There's this, like, deep tension that, like, runs as deep as families' tensions run. But I think that these medicines could open up a space for, like, families to heal together meaningfully. I know that, like, my parents haven't taken any psychedelics or whatever, but I know that the work that I've done has translated into, like, their capacity to expand to in other different ways. And I think it's just, you know, in indigenous cultures, a lot of these medicines are administered at transitionary points. And if you can change your mindset from, like, I'm no longer your child, I am now your peer, to you're my parent, but now you're now my peer, and that person is like, oh, I used to be your parent, and now I'm your peer. And, like, those transitionary moments can be really, like, deeply liberating and freeing for some of those same, again, like, have that window of, like, a flexible state, new pattern making. You can, like, release yourself from, like, the stress of, like, parenting a very young thing when it gets older. And that very young thing can release itself from the stress of trying to, like, perfectly conduct itself when you're in a space of trust and, like, kind of reforming those relationships. It can be catalyzed by these tools, potentially. This is all conjecture, a bit. But it's also validated through a lot of indigenous, like, rites of passage work with a lot of these medicines and kind of changing, like, fundamentally, like, that phase of my life is over. This is my new phase. It's a lot of rites of passage work with a lot of plant medicines. Obvious catch, if this was administered in a therapeutic container, it's like a lot more wild variability, risk, so many of you are dealing with multiple people's contraindications, managing all of that, it's just something to think about, just that, like, in this whole process, like, the overemphasis on autism equals children also simultaneously ignores autistic adults and also the parents that are navigating these challenges as well, and that they also could benefit from some healing of, like, their own guilt or shame or societal stigma that they face. About, like, their child's otherness or whatever it might be.
There's effects for siblings as well that can be really important.
Yep.
And this stuff, even outside of autism, this sort of stuff is very real and very powerful.
No, definitely. Yeah, it's been, never mind, I was going to tell you a very intimate story, but the... And this goes into the next, which would be support partner sessions. Again, this is just pulled out of my head, but it's something I really believe is important, something I've seen work in real life. It's like, hey, trying to work on your relationship, like, go with your partner into this session and work on your relationship. And there's ways that you can, like, mitigate that. I think there's an eventual model whereby people could get something almost like an Airbnb-like place where, like, there's, like, an emergency button if something really goes sideways. But otherwise, you could just kind of have, like, emergency staff present for people taking low-dose, like, safe and, like, risk-tolerated kind of sessions. But again, it goes back to the idea of, like, solving problems where they're happening, like, with the relationships that you have. There's pros and cons to it, but I think it's worth, like, voicing. Right now, we're doing the lowest risk and, like, stepping into it with, like, maximum supervision, maximum, like, container of safety. But I think there's spaciousness to allow for eventually, like, kind of take-home models for a lot of these compounds where they can solve problems inside the very home that they live in and continue on that path. and immersion therapy, I'm also partial to for the same reason. I didn't invent the word immersion, but I put that in my book and put that term in, just being immersed. My very short version of my first book was I was suicidal, I went to California, I was I hate this, I'm gonna go jump off a cliff, basically. And my friends were don't jump off a cliff, just go do LSD. And I was that sounds fine, as long as I can not be in my head for a second. And then I went deeply into my body, got really connected to everyone that I was with. And I had the experience of feeling safe with other people, feeling connected with other people for a while. And what I did was I basically lived at backpacker hostels where I was traveling and I'd work trade or whatever. And we were doing low to moderate doses of psychedelics while I had a batch of new humans coming through or something. I self-subjected myself to this sort of exposure of my own sort. I said hello to 500 strangers in a 6-month period who came to our backpacker hostel. And I was I failed spectacularly through a lot of it, but then I kind of got it. And there was a study we skipped over, but LSD actually showed that it tampens down the mechanism that triggers feelings of shame and rejection. So having that little bit of invincibility, it could go the other way where you're blind to just messing up. But at the same point, there was a softness and an ease of putting myself intentionally in that setting when I had that enhanced kind of feeling of interconnectedness. And that was just kind of how I went through it. I was just I'm just gonna figure out how to human if it takes me many, many attempts. And it was really helpful to have that. And we're working with Beckley now. They have a residential care model for Alzheimer's patients with LSD, and we want to potentially bundle that with residential care for autism too. Because again, going back to Dr. Watts' talk, this isn't a one and done thing. We'd love to put people at the center where they're oh, I had an insight yesterday, and they can have a whole 2 days to talk about someone that also had that insight and meaningfully integrate with those people and potentially live with them short to mid to long term, almost I make the joke of we're a sober living facility, getting sober from cheese stories that we have in our heads kind of thing. And it can be helpful. And so I'm a big proponent of this. It's not going to happen anytime soon. It's kind of happening in our Microdose Mondays thing, but good luck getting LSD take-home tablets anytime soon from a pharmacy or something. But it would be great. I would love to see it for the same reason I mentioned earlier, LSD lasting all day. Psilocybin could have a similar benefit. And I talk about a lot in my book. This is the final thing, and then might have a few minutes for questions in the room. But this is fairly obvious, and this will also be included along with a really great worksheet. A shout out to a gentleman named, I'll remember their name in a second. But if you are a practitioner, if you're looking to work in Oregon, or if you're working in your practice, these are just good general reminders. And this is stuff that I've been asked to advise on for retreat centers that are opening. What do we need to do to accommodate these people? There's certain things like social comforts, giving structured socializing, meeting games and stuff like that can be good. But so also can be things do you want to bring in comfort objects? Also doing the same way you'd ask if you have food allergies, you'd be do you have a sensory accommodation support need? Do you need for there to never be direct lighting? Do you prefer white noise or zero noise? Would you like us to provide you with ear protection or eye protection or whatever it might be? And similarly, considerations of how do you best process information for neurodevelopmental conditions. It's quite obvious. Anyone that does work in executive function coaching, it's really obvious. But people don't always think about that. That's why I provided the option. I think one or two people opted into it to have live transcripting. A simplified version of that is something like Otter AI as an app. It just does live transcripting for you. When I go to conferences, I just turn it on and just read the conference because it helps me retain it better. And then it's also just there for later. But I do better when I can listen and read at the same time, and maybe lots of people do. We just haven't normalized having a cell phone out in a classroom yet, but for certain things it's super useful to have transcriptions and things like that just be normalized. And if any of you guys are in the education, even if you're just doing a workshop, or if you do telehealth and you have a call, just providing, I have a thing on my website where I say, hey, do you want to have a call with me? Would you prefer this to be just an audio call, audio with video, or just text? So people go into a Zoom call with me, video and audio off, and they get 45 minutes of typing with me because that's their preferred method. And that's the way they retain things, and that's the way they feel easy, safest expressing things. Just to remind people that any and all of those communications are valid for that individual, and it can be deeply therapeutic for them. I kind of touched on it, but if someone has a visual thing, address it with a support. Same with sound. Some examples are the you know, loop has like a kind of noise reducing. Things like white noise, which might think be helpful for some, might be like kind of triggering for others, like just kind of always considering the individual. Same with like kind of texture-based accommodations. Talked about it a bit, but just taking into account learning modes. And for nonverbal clients, you know, allowing assistive devices, text message options, like I just talked about, having like agreed upon gestures, especially in altered states. I talked about Sasha Shulgin. If you ever get a chance to read Tikal, he has this whole long thing about how they tested their molecules at their house, and it's super interesting because he invented like 80 novel synthetics, and like they just invited their friends over to try them. And so like they had this whole system of like they had this thing they called hand in the air when they had like a problem that was like an actual problem, not like a existential one. They're like, hand in the air, and they're like, what? They're like, bathroom, I don't know. Like, so like, if people wandered into different states, they had these like kind of like agreed on rule sets. And there's a comfort in that. We actually, at a retreat that we just did, we had a thing that was anything but talking day, where everyone was free to not have to talk the whole day, and everyone loved it. Like, talking is exhausting for some of us. And they were able to like gesture and dance and like follow each other and mimic each other. It was like total freedom when the rule was agreed, like, hey, we're not talking today. It was like the number of people who like lit up from that, like permission to not have to do the thing they don't like to do, was tremendous. So like tapping into those modes can be helpful. Last couple things, group considerations. Just honor the comfort level depending on the client. Group psychedelic sessions are either going to be super overwhelming or maybe an opportunity to overcome a barrier. But start with small victories. I always, generally, from all my experiences, would say starting with a solo session is absolutely critical in autistic populations. Like, have them feel comfortable in their bodies first before they feel comfortable in their bodies with other people. I think that's just almost like a given. Like, I don't, you could kind of make some argument like, oh, jump over the waterfall, man. It's like, no, you don't have to. Like, go to the kiddie pool, acclimate, go to like the next. But I'm a big proponent of just starting with just solo sessions in a state with their most trusted person they have in their life, have them there with them, and then go to group stuff. And providing abundance, like so much abundance of food, so much abundance of options of music to change to, things like that, can be really helpful. And this is what I mentioned that August and Werner put together. It's like a 5-page worksheet that's like, is your clinic or center set up to accommodate all of these things? And if not, here's a worksheet of like a roadmap of how to implement these things, which includes like financial considerations, sliding scale, everything and all things. They did an awesome job of putting this together, and they donated it to this class for free as well. So they have like somewhere there on the internet, you can Google them and thank them if you find it to be useful, because it's an incredible resource. And they just literally, I was like, can I? They're like, no, we want people to have this, because not enough places even think about the checklist of these things that are on here. So as far as other moment research, again, I'm just going to gloss over this and also this. These are all just MDMA studies that are looking at effective touch and certain ways that sensory touch might be enhanced with MDMA. Also, just in general, pop, not super important at this moment. This was a study that looked at psilocybin versus an SSRI, looking at rumination, which has relevance to this population, because rumination was reduced, but people were still able to kind of process their emotional experiences, which has a high degree of relevance to the autistic group. And this last one that was mentioned was a group format trial where they essentially, the main takeaway was that they gave them music and they assessed whether or not people liked having choice or no choice with the music that was playing. And this wasn't an autistic study, but I think it's super important that, like, in all my experience with group work with autistic populations, like, everyone needs the equivalent of, like, their own containers worth of space to be inside of. Especially for those of us who are just, like, we think that we're, like, dissociative, but in fact we're, like, hyper empaths, and we're, like, oftentimes, like, anytime I've like seen various autistic people in certain contexts, like I've seen a lot of people kind of go deeply into other people's like stuff during sessions and like giving them a sort of energetic safe space to be in. I think that's just universally true for people, but in this study they found the same. Like, they all felt that the group dynamic was great for it, because this was just published like 2 months ago. The group was great, but they felt that they wished they had a little bit more control over like the music itself or their own headphones to like change different stations and things like that. So it goes back to that like abundance and ability to have control. Final thing.